ministry, and so, man, you guys are just trying to make, now I'm wondering what y'all did this weekend. Anyway, no, that's all right. we're entering into a partnership with them, so we want to keep them around. Let's see. Easter worship times. I want you all to notice this morning, y'all got these books. Everybody got one? Hold them up. Everybody get one? Anybody not get one? Okay, what are these? I'm going to tell you a story. When I first came to faith, it was my wife. I've told the story where my wife said that if I didn't go to church, she was going to stop feeding me. You all know the story of that vile act, right? It was a vile act, trust me. Well, I started going to church, and it was around Christmas time, and I was going now and again, trying to figure this all out, and then I went to Palm Sunday service, and my mind was intrigued. And Pastor caught me and said, you know, Phil, you ought to probably come to all these services this week. Tell us the whole gospel story. So I said, okay. So I went to Monday, Thursday, and my mind was excited. And then I went to Good Friday, and my mind was blown. And I went to Sunday, and it meant something amazing. And I've always thought forevermore that this was one story. And all these years, I've tried to get the church that I was serving to do something like this, and they never did. And well, now it's I'm in charge. So this is what we're gonna do. And Debbie worked really uber hard at getting this done. So if you get a chance to tell Debbie thank you, please do, because she really put a lot of effort, and she had a whole team of people that volunteered, but she ramrodded getting these books done. But if you'll notice inside the book, there is an invitation. And then after the invitation, there is a devotional for the week of Easter. And we've been working on walking with Mark as he was on his way throughout this Lenten season. And some of the stories that we were not able to get to in worship are covered here in the devotional. And there's one for every day of Holy Week, okay? And so you get to kind of get the rest of the story. And then you're going to notice that you get into the worship bulletin, basically, except they're in a lot more depth, and they help us tell the story, because I know from my own experience, it helped light my faith journey on fire. It brought me nearer to God when I recognized that it was one story. And so we want to invite everyone to be at all four of these services, hear the fullness of the gospel message. Hear the fullness. I mean, it's hard to understand Easter Sunday if you don't understand what happened on Palm Sunday. It's hard to understand Easter Sunday if you don't understand what happened on Thursday. It surely loses its power on Sunday if you miss Friday. So it's one story, and we put it in one book, and we've put it in your hands this weekend. But Phil, I'll lose it between now and Sunday. How many are thinking that? I hope you do. Cool, huh? Hannah's over here going, yes, okay? I put these in your hands this week because I want you to invite someone you know who needs to hear the gospel story. I want you to give them the book, because when you get here next week, there'll be more. I want you to take these out to your neighbors, your friends, people you work with, somebody you run into, I don't care, but I want you to give them a book and let them know that we're excited, and we're impassioned, and we are inviting them to come and hear the fullness of the gospel story with us for Holy Week. So you got them this week, and they are yours to pass out. They're yours to invite others to come and hear the gospel story. Let them know the good news of the gospel. So that's what we have this morning. Gary has an announcement he would like to share with you. See, I almost forgot. I warned you.
Anything? There we go. Yeah. Thanks. Some of you may have noticed the fascia surrounding the church. That's all the white trim that's above the brick. It's looking pretty tacky. Even Pastor Phil noticed it was looking a little shabby. So the trustees put together a program to either paint or replace what is there with permanent siding. The lowest bid on painting was $5,000 plus, and the lowest bid on replacing the fascia, giving the church a more modern look, was $15,000, all the way up to $29,000. So the trustees would like to solicit any support anyone could give us towards that project, and we'll just go accordingly. So thank you.
Thank you. So we'll be discussing how we're going to take care of that, and so you'll be hearing more about that. We'll probably need some special gifts around it, but fear not, because worst comes to worst, I bet I get some buds together and we can paint it Husker red. I'm not sure I got the shocked look I intended on that one. Y'all, good morning. Isn't it wonderful to be here? Let us set our hearts and minds right, and let us worship this morning.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Has told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow. Who imagined the sun in the source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender.
Yes, I surrender.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Shine your light
and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King.
Loving God of a new day in the colors of a sunrise, through the give and the glow of your presence, we see your face and the work of your hands. Humbly, we thank you for all that you have created and all you have done for our good. We love you and we thank you. Amen. Let us now join, to God be the glory, hymn 98. Let us join in the opening prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord, we look to you when in hunger. We look
to you when we thirst. For you are our God, who meets us in our needs. We prepare ourselves in times of abundance. We have pride in our own abilities to provide. Thank you, Lord, for all the ways you love us. Be patient with us, Lord, until we humbly understand all that you have provided. We need to say, Lord, do not turn away. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you. As we have received grace and love in Jesus Christ, let us share Christ's peace with one another. Amen.
You may be seated. Today's scripture is Psalm 118, verses 19 through 24. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate, the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become a cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad. And the kids can come up for the children's message.
Good morning. How are you this morning? I can't hear you.
Good.
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 How are you?
Good.
Good. It's okay. How are you?
Good.
Good.
Well, we got a lot of good people. I'm feeling pretty well. I just got this sore throat that swelled up this morning, and it's not too great. But you know what? When we're here, why is it that we're here? Anyone know? Why are we here? To learn about God, absolutely. And also to worship God. And we worship God because He does so much for us through His love. And our love that we return back to Him is through our worship and our actions, what we do and what we say. Does it matter? Does it matter what we do and what we say? Oh yeah, it does. If we do nasty things and we say nasty things, we're not doing God the justice that we should. But when we're saying things and doing things for others, that's when God knows that we love Him back. God's love never changes, no matter what we do, even when we do the evil things. And God has so much love for us that He gave Jesus, and He allowed His only Son to die so that our sins could be washed away, So when we mess up, before we can even turn and say, I'm sorry, they're washed away by Jesus' actions here on earth. So when you think about what you're going to do and what you're going to say, you might think, is that what God would want me to do? Is that what Jesus would do? And then you go on from there. Would you bow your heads in prayer for me? Dear God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your Son and all that you have done for us. Lord, we put a special blessing upon each of these children that are with us here today. Help them to know you and to begin to act like you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Song that Lynn and I have chosen to share with you this morning is entitled He Loved Them to the End by Joseph Martin. When Jesus knew his hour was come, the hour had come for him to die. He prayed, the Father's will be done. In deepest grief, his spirit cried.
Oh, what boundless love the Father showed when God, his only Son, he sent. And those he loved who took his life, he loved them to the end. When Jesus hung upon the cross, what perfect love he freely and taking sin upon himself, he chose to die to face the grave.
Oh, Jesus came to share his life. He came our broken hearts to mend,
and those he took his life, yet he loved them to the end.
Oh, Jesus, gentle Savior, you endured a world of scorn.
Oh, of love, in you new hope is born. When Jesus rose to conquer death, the power of God was then displayed. He proved that love would always be of those who know the way. This is covenant of peace. His promise, comfort he would send. I will never leave you. You are not
outstanding. Thank you. We've been studying Mark as he was on his way to Jerusalem. Last week he was in Jericho, which is just north of Jerusalem. And this week I had to step a little bit out of order because this was one story I wanted to be able to tell, but it's right after he arrives in Jerusalem. So next week, don't be surprised, on Sunday he actually arrives in Jerusalem. We're just setting the time machine a little forward, bear with me. The story appears in all three of the synoptic gospels, which is Mark, Matthew, and Luke, okay? And it is, Jesus has had, just before this happens, Jesus had his authority questioned by the chief priests and the Pharisees. He had already challenged their authority in the story before this one, basically saying, "Who are you to challenge me? Are you not called to speak for God, but yet you are disobedient?" And then he figured as long as he had their attention and they are already mad, he would follow up with this parable. Hear now the word of God, Mark chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. Jesus then began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a pit for the winepress, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the tenants to collect from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. But they seized him, beat him, and sent him away empty-handed. Then he sent another servant to kill them. And they killed him. They struck this man in the head and treated him shamefully. He sent still another, and that one they killed. He sent many others. Some of them they beat, others they killed. He had one left to send, a son whom he loved. He sent him last of all, saying, "They will respect my son." But the tenants said to one another, "This is the heir. Come, let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours." So they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. Haven't you read this passage of Scripture? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Then the chief priests and the teachers of the law and the elders looked for a way to arrest him because they knew he had spoken a parable against them, but they were afraid of the crowd, so they left him and went away. Let us pray. Holy, mighty God, we thank you for a glorious morning. We thank you for a morning for us to gather. We thank you for those who have gathered here together. Lord, we thank you for their presence in this place as we seek to draw near to you. And Lord, we thank you for your presence here, revealed by the relationships that we share one to another. Lord, we ask you right now, please, help us to become a quiet people. Separate from all the other distractions. Let us listen for your still and quiet voice, Lord. Help us to focus. And Lord, as I lead in this time, I ask you, please, allow me to diminish so that you are revealed all the more. Lord, we love you and we thank you. Amen. I thought that I would show a video clip of something that how many of y'all know the movie Rudy? Anybody know the movie Rudy, the story? A young man played high school football, and he wanted to play at mighty Notre Dame, but he was kind of undersized, but he made up for that by being slow. Y'all know the story? Okay. And so he worked really hard to get on the team. He was always at practice, and he was always getting beat up. And he worked his way all the way to his senior year, and he's never seen the field. And it's the last game of the season, his senior year. It's senior day, and his folks are in the stands, and the game is coming down. And just before this clip, they were trying to figure out, Rudy played defense, and they were trying to figure out a way to get Rudy into the game, his teammates, okay? And the offense took the field, and the coach says, kneel it out, okay? Just end the game on offense. Rudy wasn't going to get a chance to play. And that's when we're picking up the clip. So can we turn this on? It's a contemporary version of the parable we just heard, I think.
Rudy.
Outstanding. I wonder what a quarterback sack in front of 80,000 screaming people on national TV feels like. Oh, wait, it's awesome. The part I forgot to present was as they were told to knee it out, they took the field in, and they got in the huddle, and they said, what are we going to do? Rudy hasn't gotten to play yet. So when everybody in the stadium and even the other team expected them to knee it out, they threw a long bomb to score a touchdown so the defense could get back out on the field. Okay, that's what you missed. So that is a great story. And let's see if, I want you to keep that in your brain as we work through this, and let's see if we can't figure out how I'm connecting the dots here. There's some historical realities to this parable. It would have been common practice, and it would have been understood that if somebody had inherited land from a relative in another area, or if they were moving to be with family or something, that a landlord he would prepare the field. Okay, you'll notice that he put a hedge around it; it was well defined. He put in a watchtower so that the harvest could be protected. He prepared well for tenants to come in, and they would crop share the property. Usually it would be like a 50-50 type of an agreement. He would prepare the field, they would come in and plant, and they would harvest, and then they would share the harvest 50-50. The part of the parable where it says, if we kill the son, then we can take the inheritance, okay? In their culture, that was real. If there was a landlord that had gone away and he passed away and there was not an heir, possession was 9/10 of the law. If you ever wondered where that came from, that's where it came from, okay? So if they were in possession and no heir was available, they got to keep the land, okay? So it was not unheard of what they were speaking about. Now, when the landowner found out that his son had been killed, that is breaking of the commandments, obviously, and it's called conspiring to murder in their tradition, and he would have been within his rights to show up and to pursue his own justice with them, and then to turn the farm over to a better tenant, a more worthy, more loyal tenant, okay? What does this all mean? Who's the man? Who's the landowner in this parable? You guys know? It's God. God is the landowner. The land itself is God's chosen. It's the Hebrew people. The improvements, the way that he prepared the field, this is God's words and the teaching of the ancestors. The tenants was the Jewish leadership. Those who were conspiring to become the heir or equal in voice and in their intent and in their judgment of God. The servants, those were the prophets. Notice they were beaten or they were stoned or they were killed. Jeremiah was beaten, John was beheaded, and there are so many that were stoned. The son is obviously Jesus. Jesus self-identifies himself as the son. Did you notice it was the son whom he loved? Did you catch that part? Jesus self-identifies as the son. He is not a prophet. He is greater than that. He is the son, the heir of God. Jesus again predicts his own violent death at the hands of disobedient people. Did you catch that part? When Jesus says, and then when the son comes, they will violently kill him. That's a really important point. We'll talk about that more in just a minute. Jesus asked them, how can they claim obedience to God and yet reject God's own messenger? In verse 10, he speaks about the stone rejected, the cornerstone. This is brought to us from Psalm 118, which we read earlier. What is Jesus to be the cornerstone of? Have you thought about that? He's the cornerstone of God's desire. And what is God's desire? We're here. It's the church. It's the universal church. It's the small c Catholic church. It is the church of Jesus Christ. It is the church of worship and glory of God's own Son. That is God's desire. And it is this, that Jesus is the cornerstone, the foundation of that. Who are the more worthy tenants? Did you guys catch that? It will be turned over to somebody more worthy. Who is that? It's you. It's me. It's Gentiles. The Hebrew people had spoiled the land, and so God was spreading it into other peoples. God has chosen a different path, a different way, and a different people. This changes things. God will soon relate to humanity in a different way. God will relate to humanity through grace and through individual relationships. We no longer have to work our way to heaven by sacrifices, because the ultimate and the greatest and the perfect sacrifice is about to be made. And we will have a bridge, a doorway, a direct view into God's self, individually and personally. This is the new landscape that he is preparing. So as we read through this, we'll tell the story again. As Jesus began with the parable, God planted a people, and he protected them, and he prepared the way for them to be successful. Then God turned the people over to religious leadership, and he moved his attention to another place. At harvest time, he sent his prophets for the fruit, and they were killed. And then he sent his own son, Jesus, whom they also killed. And then the disobedient would say to one another, "We have become the heir," but God will come and remove that from them, and he will turn it over to a new people, you and me. Does that help you to understand this parable better? What does this all mean? It tells us about the generosity of God. The vineyard was equipped with everything that was necessary to make the work of the cultivators easy and profitable. God is generous in the life and in the world that he gives to humanity. It tells us of the trust of God. Now, it implies that he, through the parable, that he went away. But you know what? I think that's not quite what happened. I don't accept that, because God has truly come near in the form of Jesus Christ. God has said, this way isn't working, and he gave us a new way, a new personal pathway into righteousness, Jesus' very own righteousness. God has prepared the way for us to be acceptable to God. Man, think about that. God has made a way for me. I mean, doesn't he know how goofy I am? Doesn't he understand that I'm kind of not real pious, and, you know, my righteousness may be in question, I don't know, and I wear camouflage. I should have brought out my monocle today because my wife's not here. Think about it. I've done some horrible things, and I've thought some terrible things, and I've said some terrible things, and I haven't always loved those who are disenfranchised, and I haven't always fed the hungry, and Lord knows I haven't always clothed the cold. I haven't always sought the poor. I don't always do that. Sometimes I forget. Sometimes I'm busy. Sometimes I'm tired. Sometimes I'm distracted. I'm human. But God's own righteousness, the righteousness of Christ, is given to me because he loves me. Do you understand the significance of that move, that the love that must take? This is amazing, amazing word. Do we choose obedience or moral relativism? Does everybody understand what moral relativism is? That's when we justify what we want to do. Okay? I love Coca-Cola. I mean, some people enjoy a Coca-Cola. I love Coca-Cola. Okay? At one point in my life, I drank a 12-pack a day of 20 ounces. Okay? Now, how many of you here say that had to be good for you, Pastor? Okay? Couple of things happened because of this obsession I had with Coca-Cola. At one point, I weighed, a year ago last January, I weighed 360 pounds. Do you know that? I was a lot of board of love, tell you what. I mean, I look like Friar Tuck, all right? Yeah, especially with my hood on, you know what I mean? And the second thing that happened was my beginning of the battle of my kidney stones. Anybody ever have a kidney stone? Okay, how many remember my third week here? Okay, after service, I had all these people going, Pastor, why are you mad at us? I wasn't mad at you, I was passing a kidney stone. I was just grouchy altogether, okay? So I discovered that perhaps it had something to do with my weight gain, and it certainly, because they test those things, did you know that? They come back and they said, hey, Phil, you have a rock of Coca-Cola. Nicely done. So a year ago January, I quit drinking Coca-Cola. I still see a Coca-Cola, and I want it. Oh, I want it bad. I mean, there are days like, you know, the kids will come over and they'll have a Coke in their hand. And I think to myself, I'm still young. I can have another kid. I'm going to kill him for that Coke. I want one so bad. You know what I mean? I mean, it was terrible, right? But I quit drinking Coca-Cola. And from January through July, I passed 6 kidney stones. So I had this constant reminder. And I lost 87 pounds. Think about that. Okay? I guarantee you, Doc Hoganson, my doctor, might have mentioned once or twice he was concerned about my weight, thought maybe my Coca-Cola habit was less than healthy, perhaps I should check my ways. But see, it helped me keep up with kids. I was a youth pastor. I needed the energy. It made me happy, and a happy youth pastor is a good thing. Moral relativism is when I'm doing that dumb thing that everybody around me knows is dumb, that thing that feels unnatural even to yourself, and I know it's stupid, but I drink a Coca-Cola anyway because I need it to justify something else in my life that I want the Coke, so I do it to keep up with kids. I want the Coke, so I do it to stay awake. Okay? So what happened? I replaced Coca-Cola with coffee. I haven't had a problem with that yet. There's something wrong with me. Moral relativism is when we try to justify that thing we want in something that sounds good and holy, you know? It seems right because, well, this is a good reason, even though God says no. That's moral relativism. Moral relativism is when we think we know better than God or Dr. Hoganson, okay? That's what moral relativism is. So the question is, are we obedient to God or do we seek moral relativism? Do we seek God's glory or do we seek our very own? I want you to kind of think about that as you move through your faith journey. It tells us of the patience of God. Not once or twice, but many, many times, the master gives the cultivator, the tenants, an opportunity to repent and to return to him the harvest that he was due many, many times, and then finally even his own son. But the thing that is going to happen, God may be incredibly patient, but in the end there will be judgment. In the end, God will know God's justice. God may bear long with our disobedience and rebellion, but in the end, God alone is God. This parable tells us something about Jesus. It tells us that Jesus regarded himself not as a servant, but as a son, as an heir. He deliberately removes himself from the succession of prophets. They were just servants, but he was the heir. He was the son. In him was God's last and final word being spoken. This parable was a deliberate challenge to the Jewish authorities because it contains the unmistakable claim that Jesus himself was Messiah. It tells us that Jesus knew he was going to die, doesn't it? Now I want you to put that in your brain. Jesus knew he was going to die, and he knew how it was going to go down, and yet he walked that path anyway. He was on his way all month. For the last 40 days, we've been looking at Jesus on his way to that moment. What does that tell us of courage? What does that tell us of love? Think about that. Jesus told, he tells us right here, he knows what is to come, and yet he continues on his way. It tells us that Jesus was sure of his ultimate triumph. He also knew that he would be mistreated. He knew that he would be killed, but he knew that that was not the end of the story. The story would continue. God would be glorified, and humanity would know salvation through his sacrifice. Jesus understood all these things and never veered, continued on his way. The parable tells us something about humanity. There could only be one reason why the cultivators thought they could kill the son and then enter into possession of the vineyard. They must have thought that the owner was too far removed from them, or that perhaps the owner was dead. God is so far from us, we can do whatever we want. Think about that. Think about how we live that out even today. I mean, we have technology. We can talk to each other. We can share the word. Can't we? I mean, my kids in Nebraska, and I can call them at a moment's notice. My parents in Arizona, and assuming they hear the phone, they'll answer it. Okay? Yeah, my dad's deaf. It's tragic. We yet still act as if God is far away. You know, in youth ministry, I have this great example. And it's wonderful. So I want all of you to kind of revert yourself back to your teenage years. Everybody ready to go? I got our imagination cranked up. Those of you who are teenagers, just be there, okay? All right? And I always tell the kids as I try to explain this concept to them, I said, you know, here's my question. The conversation you had at school today with your friends, would that have sounded different if I was standing next to you? What do you think? Do you think the way you would have described the incident might have been different? Would you have used perhaps different, less colorful words? Would you have talked differently about the person that you were talking about? Would you talk differently if I was standing next to you? And the kids begin to wiggle. You know how kids do. Well, you know, and I'm like, well, you know, I'm just Phil. Do you understand God is with you? Do you understand God is with you in that conversation? God is with you deeply. Even the things you didn't say, God is present in your thoughts. God knows your heart. If you're going to wiggle if I stand there, why don't you wiggle knowing God is there? We treat God as if he's so far removed, he can't see us and he can't hear us. And it's not true. He sees us and he hears us. Every word, every thought, every moment of selfishness, every moment of greed, every moment of anger, every moment of rage, he experiences that. That's why we need a Savior. That's why Jesus maintained his way to the cross. This is the truth. But these tenants, they felt their landlord was so far removed, or perhaps he's dead. We can inherit this. We can become equal to God. That's what they're saying. Does that make sense? God's not here. That's what this parable tells us. One thing this parable tells us about humanity. And here's another. If a man refuses his privileges and his responsibilities, they pass on to someone else. The parable reveals what was to come, the rejection of the Jews and the passing of their privileges and responsibilities to the Gentiles. I have made this comment a few times, and I'll say it again, because it happens over and over. And if you take a look at today's political climate, I'm not going to enter into it, but I'm just going to make an observation, okay? When there is a vacuum of leadership, okay? What is a vacuum? That means that it doesn't exist. When there's a vacuum of leadership, leadership will rise. It just won't always be healthy. When there is a vacuum of leadership, leadership will rise, but it won't always go the way that we know it ought to. That is the church, people. You take a look at the church history, and you can find lots of things that we're not necessarily proud of. Who in here has ever heard of the Inquisition? Or the Crusades? Or, we can pick a few more if you want, but that's enough, you know? We haven't always behaved as if God was watching. We haven't always behaved as if what we did really mattered eternally. We often behave as if what only matters is immediate and for our own self-gratification. What this parable teaches us about humanity is that God is present. There will be a reckoning, and that God is God. God's grace is not earned. God's grace is not a right. God's grace is not anything other than what God's grace is, a free gift. Jesus loves you so much, he maintained his way so that you could rest in his very own righteousness, his very own. The Son, the heir of God. Keep that in mind. In the end, the Levites and the Pharisees knew that Jesus had shamed them and had challenged their authority. They felt Jesus should pay for this with his life, but they feared what the crowd would do. See, the crowd was cheering him on. Rudy, Rudy, right? The crowd was cheering them on. They were fired up. They loved what they were hearing. They loved to hear that some of the oppression they felt from their leadership was not God's way. And they were excited about what they were hearing. And they said, if we take him now and put him to death, there will be a riot. And if there are riot, then the Romans will get mad. And if the Romans get mad, perhaps they'll stop supporting our authority. And then what'll happen to us? So they began to conspire against Jesus in the shadows. And that prepares us to enter into Holy Week. Amen? Let us stand now and sing our hymn 385. The first verse is going to be they're going to sing a solo because it's a new hymn. And then we will join in on the second verse.
Is shown, God it is who justifies, only faith the grace applies. Active faith that lives within conquers hell and death and sin, hallows whom it first made whole, forms the Savior in the soul. everlasting life is won. Only let us persevere till we see our Lord appear. Never from the rock remove, saved by faith which works by love.
You may be seated. Now we enter into that time of service where we get to share the stuff that's happening in our world. What joys and concerns do we have as a congregation? I'm going to share a few that I know about. Larry Goranson had hip surgery Thursday morning, and I am told he is doing very well. So let us keep Larry's continued healing. Bill Welcher was in the hospital, but he's here today. Where you at, Bill? Okay, he left? He'll be right back. And when he comes in, everybody point and laugh. Will they do that for me? Okay, but Bill was in the hospital, and I was planning to meet him there, but I saw him here, so that means we're on the mend, so let's keep Bill's healing grace going. And then Cliff Cole, I understand he is in the hospital, so let us keep Cliff in prayer. My mother had her third chemo on Wednesday, and she calls me in the afternoon, and usually when she gets home, she's kind of, you know, nappy. She wants to take a nap, and she calls me, and she's all excited. I said, "What's up, Mom?" And she said, "I got the most beautiful shawl from some ladies in your church, and I wanted to say thank you." And I said, "Yeah, Mom, that's a prayer shawl." And she says, "What's a prayer shawl?" I said, "They prayed into every little knot they tie on that thing. That thing is bathed in prayer. And so when you put it over you, you are bathed in prayer." And my mother wept. Thank you for those of you who thought to do that. It is a wonderful ministry, the prayer shawl. Is there any others that we'd like to bring up? Yes. Well, that's a good place to bring it. So we will keep you in prayer. In fact, let's do so right now. Shall we do it? Lord God, we ask you please to enter in, and we ask you to extend your healing grace on one who seeks your healing. Lord, we ask you please to just walk with us and help her to know that she is loved, and guide the hands of the doctors and all who provide care, and let your healing be made known today. Lord, this we pray. We love you. Amen. Never a bad time to pray. Others. Oh, there he is. Okay, I'm in trouble now. All right. Y'all remember that part where I said I wasn't perfect? Example. Okay, so with that said, y'all, let's enter into prayer, shall we? Holy and loving God, we thank you for this time you've given us to be here together to share the stuff of our lives. Lord, we thank you for the good things, the goodness, the amazing things that you provide for us. The loving relationships that we share, Lord, where we get to share in your image with family and friends. Lord, we ask you please to be with those we've lifted up who are seeking to know you in a time of healing today. Lord, let your healing be profound. Let your healing amaze doctors. Let your healing be spoken of in clinics. Lord, let your healing be known right now. Lord, this we pray. And Lord, for those who are seeking to know you in darkness. Darkness that comes from situations, darkness that comes from bad decisions, darkness that comes from poverty, darkness that comes from addiction. Lord, for all the ways we find our way into the dark, oh Lord, we thank you that you love us enough to chase us with a light. Lord, let your light shine. This we pray. Amen. And now let us prepare to return to God a portion of the abundance that we have received.
Embrace the cross where
sacrifice will seem small beside the treasure eternity can't measure. What Jesus holds in store, embrace the love the cross requires. Cling to the one whose heart knew every pain. Receive from Jesus fountains of compassion. Only he can fashion your heart to move as his. Oh, wondrous cross, our desires rest in you. Oh, Lord Jesus, make us bolder to face with courage the shame and disgrace you bore upon your shoulder. Embrace the life that comes from dying. Come trace the steps the Savior walked for you. An empty tomb concludes Golgotha's sorrow. Endure then till tomorrow your cross of suffering. Embrace the cross.
The cross of Jesus.
Embrace the cross. The cross of Jesus.
Let us pray. Loving God, we ask you, please, accept these, the fruits, our fruits. Lord, the fruit of the harvest we share with you. Lord, we pray that you will use them. You will use them in such a way that others will become fruit of the field for future harvest. Lord, we ask you, please, to just use this that we return to you so that your light can shine. But we limit not just this to this. We offer you our very selves as well, Lord. Lord, let us be the energy. Let us be the energy in our prayer. Let us be the energy of your love. Let us seek to find those living in darkness, Lord, and let us bring your light. Lord, we lend you the strength of our voices in justice, our hearts in your mercy. Lord God, let our hands always be in your service. Lord, this we pray, oh, as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power, the glory forever, Lord God. Amen. And now let us share in our closing hymn. It has been a wonderful morning of worship. I am so glad that we all decided to get up early or on time. When shall we stop ceasing to try to control God? Let him set the time. Anyway, I'm obsessing. I'm moving on. Okay, all right. So with that, y'all, let's have a wonderful week. And Lord, it is the prayer of our heart, Lord, the desire of our very being, that you will create in us to be vessels of your Spirit so that others will experience you loving them through us. Oh, and let them say there is something special, truly special about Jesus Christ. Oh, and they wish to know him more. Lord, this is our prayer. Let it be so. We love you. Amen.